We hear the busy signal. We are working to resolve that. Thank you.
Good morning. We're going to get started. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Glenn McGurk, and I work on the Medicare Clinical Laboratory Fee Schedule Policy for CMS in the Division of Ambulatory Services. Once again, it's our pleasure here at CMS to host the annual public meeting for clinical services, clinical lab services. We'd like to welcome everyone here, those that are listening in on phone lines, and those watching our live stream. At this time, I'd like to introduce Marc Hartstein, our group director in the Hospital and Ambulatory Policy Group, to offer some welcoming remarks.
All right, thank you, Glenn. And well, it's nice to see you all here this morning. Good morning. So it's always a pleasure to receive public input, and we obviously have a large audience here for this year's annual public meeting, and we've got a number of very interesting issues and codes to discuss. We are going to be discussing drugs of abuse testing, which we got a lot of comments on, and there's some interesting comments as well on Cologuard, and then there are a number of other services that we're going to be receiving, getting public input on. So always welcome input from the public. This process is very meaningful to us. We certainly listen to all of the presentations and all of the comments that come to us at this lab public meeting. We consider all of those comments, then we publish our decisions, then we take further public comment on those decisions before finalizing those decisions later this year. So Glenn runs a very, very tight ship here. It's a we're on a schedule, and there are limitations on the amount of comments you can make. I just want you to know you can't really tell, but Glenn is the enforcer in that jacket. You can't really tell that he's been working out. He's ready to take on any people who violate the rules. Be careful. I've been on Glenn's bad side before. Don't go over your time limits. So I just wanted to take a minute to talk about the Protecting Access to Medicare Act and the rulemaking that will be coming out of that process. So as you know, on April 1st, 2014, Congress enacted the Protecting Access to Medicare Act. Section 216 of that law makes significant changes to how we determine payments for laboratory services beginning January 1st, 2017. The law requires applicable laboratories to report private payer data to CMS, and then for CMS to calculate a weighted median of those private payer rates to determine what the clinical lab fee schedule prices are going to be on January 1st, 2017. I think there has been an expectation that we would have completed rulemaking by this time and that people would know what the requirements are. Who is an applicable laboratory, what applicable information is, how they're going to report that information. There are special provisions in there for coding. There are special provisions in there for advanced diagnostic laboratory tests. There are other provisions that are in there for clinical diagnostic laboratory tests that are new but are not advanced diagnostic laboratory tests. And then there are provisions related to confidentiality, provisions relating to disclosure of information. There is a Federal Advisory Committee Act panel that's created, which we have in process. So there are a lot of complex and very difficult provisions for us to draft, and as a result, we haven't completed it as rapidly as I'm sure you might have wanted us to complete it, and not as rapidly as we would have liked to complete it. But the regulation is in process. We are drafting it. We are working very hard to address some of those complex issues, and we do hope to have it out at the soonest possible date. I can't really forecast what that date will be right now, but we're working very hard to get that rule out, to provide information to the laboratory community, and then people can make their public comments to us as we move into the final rulemaking and then towards implementation of the law. Since that is such a major change to how we determine clinical laboratory fee schedule services, I did ask Glenn if I could take a couple of minutes just to answer some questions. So if there are anybody who has any questions about that, I'll take about 5 minutes worth of questions. Please go to the microphone that's in the middle of the room, and I'll do my best to answer your question. There's not a whole lot of information that I can provide, but I will do my best to answer if I can. So does anybody have any questions, want to approach the microphone? All right, I gave you your chance. One more time. Yes, sir. So that's an excellent question, and that's a question for rulemaking. So the question was, who does this apply to? Will it apply to all laboratories? I don't really know that I can answer that question with precision, but what I can say is that any services that are currently paid under the clinical laboratory fee schedule, we will continue to pay whoever gets paid under the clinical laboratory fee schedule, just using the rates calculated using a new methodology. Or if they're an advanced diagnostic laboratory test or they're a new clinical diagnostic laboratory test that's not an advanced diagnostic laboratory test, then whatever methodology applies to them. So there's some provisions in there about gap filling, crosswalking, the types of methodologies that we use here at the annual public meeting today that will apply to those services. And then there are some special provisions for new advanced diagnostic laboratory tests where they're priced at actual list charge for three quarters. You know, if you hadn't asked that question, then Eric wouldn't be standing at the microphone right now. Yeah, you gave him too much time to think about what he wants to ask, and now he's there asking.
You need somebody to break the ice. Mark, thank you for
you broke the ice. All right. Anybody other than Eric have a question?
He knows I'm going to ask the tough question that's on everybody's mind, and that is, first of all, thank you for making those clarifying remarks. Is it still, does it continue to be the agency's expectation that given the timing that you will be able to implement the program as specified with the timelines in the statute?
So that's an excellent question.
I thank you for that.
And I'm going to do my best to say a lot of words but not answer your question, which I've developed
quite skilled at that.
I've been doing this for 25 years. I talk a lot. See if you can find an answer. So I think that's a question that the answer will probably lie in the public comment process as well as on the final rule. So I think our primary mission right now is getting the rule out. Getting the rule out and getting the rule out as soon as possible, providing as much information in that rule to the laboratory community so people can provide comments to us on those provisions, and then finalizing that rule and moving towards implementation. I would guess because of the schedule, people are going to ask the question that you've asked or make the comment that we should delay the effective date. I mean, there is a statutory effective date of January 1st, 2017, and we're working as rapidly as possible to try to get to that implementation date on time, but I imagine there's probably going to be further discussion of that question.
That's a very skilled answer. Thank you.
Anybody else have any questions? I'll take one more question if there's a question. Who wants to be the last question? All right. Thank you very much. Look forward to having a very productive discussion on the many issues that we have here today on the agenda for the lab public meeting.
Thank you, Mark. Okay, for those of you who will be presenting, we thank you for your prompt delivery of your presentations in the time frame requested. All of you should have received the information that was posted on our clinical lab fee schedule website concerning the new codes that will be discussed today. If you have any handouts, written comments, or copies of your presentations that you have not already provided to me, please make sure that you get those to me while you're here at CMS. We outlined in the Federal Register notice announcing the meeting that the public has approximately an additional 2 weeks to provide comments, which will end on August 6th, after the meeting concludes. The speakers, because we have a bunch of them, will be given a maximum time of 10 minutes to give their new code presentations. Speakers should have provided extra handouts for those attendees, which you have. Also, after the meeting, anyone interested in obtaining the electronic copies of the presentations can request them by sending an email to me, and I'll give you that information when I'm done my little speech. Please note that we will be discussing only the codes addressed in our clinical laboratory fee schedule calendar year 2016 updates, which is found on our webpage. Comments and recommendations on whether codes identified as gap-filled codes from last year's final determination is a separate and distinct process that will not be discussed at this meeting. At the conclusion of each presentation, we will have a brief open forum for questions to presenters from those in attendance. Again, please direct any comments toward the presentations regarding the new codes for 2016 that will be discussed. We will not be discussing any policy decisions during this meeting. In summary, after this public meeting, we will continue to accept public comments for approximately 2 weeks, which will end on August 6th. Then we will determine the basis of payment, either crosswalk or gap fill. And for the test codes that we determine to crosswalk, the amount of payment for the new test codes, we will then post that information on our website as soon as possible, aiming for prior to the beginning of September. Okay. At that point, we will accept and consider additional comments regarding our preliminary determinations. The basis of payment and the amount of payment become final at the same time we issue the annual CMS instruction for calendar year 2016, which will approximately be mid-November, we hope. Then the public has 60 days from the date we issue our annual instruction to request reconsideration of either the basis of payment or the amount of payment for these new test codes. The public may comment on any reconsideration requests at the next annual public meeting. In addition, for any new test code that will be gap filled, we ask our Medicare contractors to develop carrier-specific gap filled amounts by April 1st of the following year. These amounts will then be finalized on September 30th of that year. Unlike a crosswalk test, the payment for amount for a gap filled test is not established when we determine the basis for payment, because it takes approximately 9 months for our contractors to establish carrier-specific amounts. After these prices are developed by the Medicare contractors, we will post them on our website and accept comments for 60 days after April 1st. Not reconsideration requests, just comments. Later in the year, when the gap-filled payment amounts are posted on the website as final, we will accept reconsideration requests on the gap-filled payment amounts for 30 days. Once the reconsideration process is completed for a cycle, the determination is final and would not be subject to further reconsideration. As for any housekeeping issues, please note the following. If you would like a copy of the agenda, you can pick up one at the table outside the room. Many of you have. The restrooms, for those of you who don't know, are down the hall to the left before you get to the main lobby. The cafeteria, for those that don't know, is in the lower level. Okay, you can either take the stairs or the elevator. For taxi service, the guard desk in the lobby where you signed in can provide assistance. For those that may or may not know, CMS is a smoke-free campus. Please place any electronic devices on silent or vibrate. And for teleconference participants, please place your phone on mute. We will break if, you know, we'll see how it goes in terms of the presentations. The plan right now is we will break for lunch at 11:30. It'll be 11:30 to 12:30. I don't know if we will take a break in between now and then, unless a lot of people are raising their hands. So we'll shoot for 11:30 to 12:30 as our lunch break, okay? For any comments or questions, please step up to the microphone provided on the floor so all may hear you. Comments or questions have a 5-minute limit. If you have additional questions during the course of the time we are meeting here together, please do not hesitate to see me. And if you need to contact me after the meeting, I'd like to give you my contact information now. You can reach me, I'm Glenn McGurk again, at 410-786-5723. And my email address is glenn.mcguirk@cms.hhs.gov. So before we begin our presentations, I'd like to welcome my colleague, Sarah Harding, who will be providing an overview of the clinical laboratory data collection system.
Thank you, Glenn. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all again here. As Mark detailed, we do not have the policy details available regarding PAMA at this time, but I did want to take a moment just to describe our plans for being able to collect the applicable information once we are able to get those details out. We are currently building a sophisticated data collection system. The goal is for this to be an extremely secure system. We want to keep all of your data secure. We want to make sure that those who have access to it are supposed to have access. And so much of the effort right now around the system has to do with building in those security requirements. The reason I wanted to speak today was just to basically give everyone a heads up that there will be a registration process for the system ahead of time. So before any applicable lab can submit their data, they will need to have access to this system. I know it's been in the news a lot about data breaches, system breaches, and so again, the security measures that are being built into the system are pretty substantial. So when we are able to roll out some notification of the registration process, I would encourage all of you or your clients or whomever you're able to get in touch with to register for the system ahead of time. There will be questions regarding who you are. There will be some it's a soft credit check process, something for you to really make sure that you are who you say you are. There will be different user access accounts for various roles with both regards to submitting data and certifying data. Again, all of these details will be made available to you. There are several levels of help desk support that are being built into place. We will certainly intend to have training available so that all of this goes as smoothly as possible. But the bottom line is there are a lot of labs, a lot of users. If everyone waits till the last minute to get their registration information in, it's going to bottleneck the process. We do expect a few bumps, as many of the multi-factor authentication processes are really being newly integrated into CMS data collection systems. So again, the earlier you can get into the system, the better. We can work out these kinks all together. Again, the goal is to ensure that the data that are submitted remain safe, confidential, and are effective at setting CLFS payment rates. I would again just emphasize, in addition to, I know I'm sure you're all checking daily for a rule update. Also, we will push the information out. It won't be a secret, website that you have to find. We will do our best to let you know that it is out there, but that is going to be a very important step of the process. So that's all I had to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Okay, our first presenter is Jacob Ma Weaver from Cable Car Capital. Jacob.
You can either use this one, move around, or you can use this, either or. Okay. This is stationary.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Glenn, and good morning, everyone. And thank you to the staff of CMS for giving me the opportunity to speak today. I'm here to present on my reconsideration request for code G0464, which is for stool-based DNA screening for colorectal cancer, or CRC. And the trade name for that test is Cologuard. If there's really only one thing I could leave you with today, it would be that word screening. I want to emphasize that the thrust of my presentation is that I strongly believe as a taxpayer and as a member of the public that the reimbursement rate for a test intended for screening purposes as opposed to diagnostics should have a payment level that reflects that. Just to get one thing out of the way up front, I do have a small short position in exact sciences at my firm. However, while that provides me with an indirect financial incentive to research CRC screening, I want to be clear that I would not be here today if it were only for that short position. I'm here because this is my firmly held belief that the public interest would be served by a lower payment level for the test. I want to emphasize that I have not received compensation from anyone to be here, and this is my personal opinion. So, you know, with the limited pool of resources that we're all here to discuss today, I think it's imperative that CMS try to achieve the greatest possible public health benefit. Importantly, if you're familiar with the 2009 CMS decision not to cover CT colonography, CRC screening is one of a small handful of therapeutic areas for which CMS is explicitly authorized to cover and consider cost. The Colorectal Cancer Screening Act of 1997 was part of a balanced budget amendment that expressly amended the Social Security Act for that purpose. Unfortunately, it appears in this case that the coverage and reimbursement decisions may have been made independently. While I think we can all agree that there is a price at which it makes sense to cover Cologuard, the coverage decision may not have contemplated the public health costs of the payment level that was ultimately assigned. Undeniably, there will be life years gained from any new screening protocol, particularly one that results in referrals to the standard of care, which is colonoscopy. But the question before us today is, what is the right payment level for that test? So, without further ado, I will explain why I believe the crosswalk is one that should be lowered and perhaps made with reference to different tests. Many of the slides in the presentation you'll see are intended primarily for reference. I'm not going to go through all of them in detail. Rather, I just want to highlight a few important points. So I think it's important to note, first off, as I mentioned at the beginning, that Cologuard is not a diagnostic test. It is intended for screening, and as currently recommended, it would potentially be offered to virtually all Medicare patients every 3 years. So the cost of this test ultimately has a very large impact on the budget. The test sponsor has already covered the test methodology and the nature of the test in some detail. So I'm not going to spend time on that. But the main thing to note is that Cologuard, let me just back up a little bit, is a combination of multiple different assays. So there's a FIT component, a fecal immunochemical test, as well as a DNA component as well. So 3 points I'd like you to take away from this presentation. First of all, as I mentioned at the beginning, for a population health screening test, wherever possible, I believe the crosswalking codes should be chosen so that they are based on the test's purpose as well as its methodology. Diagnostic tests are not intended to be reimbursed for screening, and there is an OIG opinion to that effect. Adding a diagnostic assay to a multi-part screening test should not necessarily increase the reimbursement rate. Secondly, the data from the pivotal trial on Cologuard, the Deep Sea study, attributes virtually all of the superiority over the comparator assay to improvements in the FIT component of the test, not its DNA components. Yet, 95% of the value in the current crosswalk is attributable to expensive DNA assays that have limited value in screening. And lastly, CMS has addressed this issue before. In 2008, when examining a prior version of Cologuard, the predecessor assay PreGen Plus, CMS conducted a cost-benefit analysis which determined payment levels above which it would not be cost-effective to reimburse the test. And the current crosswalk proposal is one that dramatically exceeds those levels. So my background is in statistics, and I want to make a couple of quick statistical observations. The first is that the Cologuard algorithm is written in such a way that a positive result on either the FIT component or the DNA component is sufficient for a positive result on Cologuard. In practice, this means that if there is a significant amount of hemoglobin in the stool, Cologuard will return a positive test result even if there is no DNA methylation detected. So where Cologuard would potentially add value over FIT is for those polyps that are shedding methylated DNA but are not bleeding. However, when we look at the FDA's analysis, the FDA found that Cologuard sensitivity to CRC of at least stage 1 was statistically indistinguishable from its own FIT component. In other words, all of the superiority between Cologuard and the comparator FIT assay for CRC detection is due to improvements in the FIT component of the test. In fairness, the FDA repeated the same area under the curve analysis when including precancers. The difference between Cologuard and the FIT component was statistically significant when precancerous adenomas are included. However, the benefit was quite small. Cologuard sensitivity to precancerous adenomas is only 42%. So in effect, the current G0464 crosswalk would reimburse an incremental $471 per test over the payment level for FIT for precancer detection that the FDA has determined has only roughly 20% predictive value. That's positive predictive value. So to illustrate the public health impact of this, I just want to note that the test is significantly less costly to produce at scale than its list price, and the incremental annual cost to CMS would be substantial if Cologuard becomes a preferred non-invasive screening modality. My recommended crosswalk would maintain Cologuard as the highest reimbursement level of any non-invasive screening test, but at the current level of reimbursement, if it were to fully replace FIT and FOBT, it would cost CMS an incremental $700 million per year. Most importantly, CMS has already addressed this issue. And the 2008 study examined a hypothetical version 2 of the test, which actually had better characteristics than Cologuard ultimately demonstrated in its trial. In particular, the study estimated that version 2 would have sensitivity of 55% to precancerous adenomas, which is significantly more than the 42% that was achieved. And their conclusions were stark. I don't believe the underlying data has changed significantly since Dr. Ann Zauber of CISNET conducted this study. And they found that if a payment level is above $80, Cologuard would cost more than the most cost-effective screening modality. For a payment above $191, both models agreed that the cost-effectiveness would be worse than all other CRC screening modalities. And the reason cost-effectiveness is such an issue for Cologuard, by the way, is the number of false positives. These result in referrals to colonoscopy, so you end up paying twice. Within the Medicare population in particular, specificity is only 83.8%, significantly lower than the headline number for the trial, because DNA methylation can also be associated with aging. Given actual CRC prevalence in the neighborhood of 6%, this means that well over 20% of Medicare patients administered a Cologuard test will be referred to colonoscopy anyway. So I just want to close by looking at the crosswalk in a bit of detail. When we look at the current crosswalk, really the only code that accurately reflects the purpose of the test, as opposed to its methodology, is 82274 for FIT. Testing for KRAS mutations, 81275, should not be reimbursed for screening at all. This is a companion diagnostic intended for patients who already have a CRC or lung cancer diagnosis. We have no data on how the KRAS or other individual biomarkers contribute to Cologuard's effectiveness. But we do know that a test for a single KRAS mutation in the predecessor test showed zero sensitivity to CRC. It therefore seems reasonable to reimburse for the DNA component, including all nine biomarkers, using a single comparator assay in the crosswalk. Turning to 81315, I suggest that the reconsidered crosswalk should include a more appropriate comparator based on the test's purpose rather than its method. 81315 appears chosen to maximize the value of the reimbursement for DNA methylation analysis, but this particular assay is an extremely rare diagnostic that is used primarily for leukemia. Reimbursing a high-volume screening test at the cost of an uncommon diagnostic assay imposes unnecessary costs on the health system. CMS has a number of Tier 2 codes which also represent methylation analysis, and my recommendation to code 81401 is actually the initial crosswalk proposal that Exact Sciences had made last year prior to making changes before the meeting. I suggest the 81401 code provisionally allocated to septin 9 methylation analysis, but ultimately this is a matter over which CMS has a fair amount of discretion. That particular test is not yet approved and may not be, but the point here is that cost and purpose should be important considerations in choosing comparator assays for the crosswalk. Lastly, I just want to note that other cost-benefit analyses appear to have been conducted by some of the MACs. These data are not public, but the chosen payment amounts for various localities certainly would appear to suggest that other independent analysis has come to similar conclusions. I encourage you to take their determinations into account. Thank you very much for your time and attention.
Any questions?
Yes. Hi, Michael Beebe. I'm a consultant with ADVI, and my disclosure is that Exact Sciences is a client. I also work with numerous other labs through the coding and payment coverage processes. So my comments are basically that pharmaeconomic models, value-based models, cost analyses, the impact on the Medicare program are not the basis for setting prices under the clinical lab fee schedule. It's very clear. They're not the basis under any Medicare fee schedule for setting prices. So much of what Mr. Ma said today really is not accurate or even relevant for our purposes here. Right now, we are discussing crosswalk and gap fill approaches to pricing. With respect to crosswalk, there's no basis for CMS to price the Cologuard test on the SEP9 test. SEP9 test is under CPT code 81401, which is a tier 2 code. It has no NLA on the clinical lab fee schedule, so there's no basis for setting a price. Further, that test significantly discounts the amount of work in the Cologuard methylation. It only accounts for one methylation test. It does not account for the two that are in Cologuard. Further, it does not account for KRAS. So, you know, not only is this, you know, this whole discussion very irrelevant for pricing on the clinical lab fee schedule, the part that is relevant is you know, not factually accurate and has, you know, no basis for setting a price. So that's all. Thank you.
I'm not sure if there was a question I should respond to there, but I would just note that my recommendation is that CMS consider test purpose as well as the methodology in the crosswalk.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you. Okay, our second speaker is, looks like it's a tag team. Kevin Conroy and Maneesh Arora from Exact Sciences.
Hi, Thank you all. Thank you, Mark and team, for having us here today. The purpose of our visit here today is to propose a crosswalk from a G code to a recently issued AMA CPT code. So I will take you through quickly a little bit of background in, let's see here, a background in colon cancer. Colon cancer is the number two cancer killer in the U.S., killing 50,000 people a year, afflicting over 130,000 people. It is a significant public health problem, and it is well recognized that colon cancer is the most preventable and least prevented of cancers. It's like cervical cancer in the 1950s. In the 1950s, cervical cancer killed 35,000 women a year. With a simple test that detected most cancers and about half of precancerous lesions, that's what the pap smear does, it has nearly eradicated the disease from 35,000 deaths per year to 3,500. Repeat screening finds precancers, they're removed, and it actually prevents the disease. Colon cancer screening has a big problem. Only about 40 to 50% of people will regularly get a colonoscopy. That's the reality. The numbers aren't changing. The FIT, the fecal immunochemical test, and the FOBT test, 10 to 20% of patients will do that test. And that test is severely deficient. Cologuard is aimed not only at detecting cancer, which you see on the right side, but precancerous polyps, which take 10 to 15 years to turn into cancer. That has to be the target, to find those polyps. One of the great things about Cologuard is as the polyp grows in size, it sheds more DNA, and despite what the proponent here said, Cologuard finds the DNA that is being shed from those cells right into the stool. The stool is analyzed, and by finding those precancerous polyps, a diagnostic colonoscopy can go and remove them. It's really a remarkable breakthrough. And this was not an easy test to develop. It's an incredibly complicated test with just the right combination of markers and technologies aimed at finding those DNA markers and also hemoglobin. There are 11 biomarkers altogether. If you take any of them out, the performance of Cologuard significantly changes. We know that, we've shown it, we've showed it to the FDA. I would say that Mr. Ma Weaver drastically mischaracterized the data that was submitted to an FDA panel, which voted 10-0, 10-0, 10-0 to approve Cologuard. Cologuard also was established in a 10,000 patient study. We did not look at this lightly. We ran one of the largest colon cancer screening tests ever conducted. And it was FDA approved and also covered through the NCD process and then priced last year. We went through a rigorous crosswalk analysis, working hard to find the right tier one codes to crosswalk to. And I'd like to point out that you'll see here there are components of the test that are not reimbursed. The collection kit is not reimbursed. The DNA normalization markers, beta actin, not reimbursed. The algorithm not reimbursed. And importantly, our customer call center that actually gets people screened, not reimbursed. Not part of the test. It's part of getting a good result and getting people screened and hopefully having an impact on this disease. What you'll see here is that you have the crosswalk, two DNA methylation markers in Cologuard to one code. We did not ask for that code to be applied twice. And that code involves additional steps than in the code that is being crosswalked to, additional steps, additional work that is not being asked for reimbursement. So the approach that was taken here was a conservative approach, and the value is there. In terms of what we're here to do today, we have great news that AMA, which, as you know, has a high threshold for issuing a new CPT code, has issued a code 81528. CMS had issued a temporary G code for Cologuard, and we're here today to ask on an administrative basis to crosswalk the G code to the CPT code, which will enable easier, smoother payment from commercial payers and also from Medicare. Let me pull up one slide. Okay, the new deck did not get pulled up. So there are three essential arguments that have been made here. Number one is that pharmacoeconomic modeling should be used. We know that that is not in the regulations. So if the rules change, we are happy to play by those rules because Cologuard stands on its own 2 feet from a pharmacoeconomic basis. As part of the NCD process, Exact Sciences sponsored research by Archimedes, an independent group, which showed that even at $600 per test, Cologuard is cost effective. The proponent points to a 2007 study that does not take into account all of the increased costs. And let's talk about those costs. The costs of treating colon cancer are approaching $20 billion a year. We know from a public health policy that if we focus on screening, you could take those costs down to the area of cervical cancer treatment, which is $3 billion. An investment in screening with colon cancer actually pays. And the cost of colonoscopy that Medicare pays all in is about $1,700. Cologuard is significantly less than that, and that's an important part of the consideration that we made when we priced Cologuard. The cost-effectiveness models that you saw here do not take into account compliance. If you don't screen half the population, it's really expensive because you end up paying for up to $300,000 per case to treat, not taking into account the human factors. Cologuard has shown in just the last 9 months to get 73% compliance within a few months of a test being ordered. That compares to 38% compliance with colonoscopy within 1 year of referral to colonoscopy. Also, it has shown that we're increasing the screening population by 40%. In the Medicare population, we're getting people screened that had never been screened before. I love to tell a story about my own father who was screened for the first time. They found an advanced precancer, safely removed it, saving the Medicare system a significant amount of cost starting a year or two from now when that most likely would have turned into cancer. And then finally, under the PAMA rules, Cologuard is going to stand on its own 2 feet because Medicare is going to end up paying what the commercial payers pay. And we are happy to stand on our own 2 feet from a cost effectiveness basis and also from a market basis because we know that the investment that we're making in helping to get people screened is going to change the way that colon cancer screening occurs in the future. I know Mr. Ma Weaver is a long way away from the screening pool, but we're happy to keep you on a special list and refer you to colonoscopy when it comes time for that. Thank you very much, and we look forward to hearing from you soon.
Any comments, questions, or anything?
I'm Steve Furrow. I work here at CMS. Just a couple of questions to respond to some of the data that we were given by Mr. Mar Weaver in the previous discussion. One was his representation of a conference call from Exact Science where supposedly the commentary on the call was that the cost per test was in the $100 to $150 range. And as the previous comment or two, Mr. Marweaver suggested we're here to determine the appropriate crosswalk based upon resources, and if the resources are in fact $100 to $150, that the current crosswalk may be inappropriate. So could you comment on that particular presentation from Mr. Marweaver?
The data that he cites there is what could occur in the future at specific volumes. Today, with about 80,000 test orders, the costs of Cologuard are approaching $400 per test today. That could change in the future with significantly different volumes. Where that will be is not determined at this point in time, but that would occur years from now, again, only with significant volumes.
The second question was the algorithm question. So could you comment, please, on the allegation that the algorithm is reads positive if the fit is positive? And if that's the case, how much does the DNA part add to the positivity in the CRC?
Yeah. So this is a really important point. Mr. Ma Weaver either misunderstands or mischaracterizes the data and says that the value of Cologuard comes from an improved fit test. There is very strong evidence to the contrary that the fit component of Cologuard detects about 70% of cancers, and that the DNA component detects about 70% of cancers. If you pull either one of those out, you miss about 20 to 25% of curable stage cancers. More importantly, you miss almost all of the precancers, because precancers typically don't bleed. So the FIT test detects about 20% of precancerous polyps. And most of that is attributed to just background positivity that ends up referring to colonoscopy. Without the DNA components of this test, you do not get to 94% detection of curable stage cancer, and the data clearly show this. We're happy to provide it if you would like to see that. And versus the FIT test, which only detects 70%. So I ask you, what test would you want to have for you and your family and for the citizens of the U.S.? One that detects 94% of curable stage cancers, or one that detects 70%? This isn't even a close call. Or one that detects only 20% of precancerous polyps versus one that detects 69% of the most advanced precancerous polyps.
Okay, our third speaker is Dr. Lee Hilborne of the American Society for Clinical Pathology.
Good morning. Thank you so much on behalf of ASCP for allowing us to present. Having been here before, I'm painfully aware of how uncomfortable it gets when everybody talks about the same codes. And so we've reviewed the work of others and, for the most part, in fact, concur with the information that's submitted. ASCP has submitted a spreadsheet that's available to you outside, and of course that's been submitted to CMS. Further, there will be additional comments from ASCP that will be forthcoming. I just want to talk about or mention a couple of issues that were worth mentioning because they're high volume. We've talked about the BRCA issues, and that influences so many women, and we recommend that that be crosswalked to a combination of 81, 211, and 13, in that that represents the service that is currently provided and describes the information that's provided. We are concerned about drug testing and what was proposed, because we don't think that the detail in a two-code strategy adequately captures that information. And lastly, although it probably is not relevant, that we are concerned, or we ask that the OB code be mapped to the new OB code that includes HIV be mapped to a combination of the two. With that, we're looking forward to the other presentations that we've had an opportunity to review, and for the most part, we concur with those recommendations. And again, our final summary will come before August 6th.
Hang on one second. Oh, okay. Thank you. Our fourth speaker is Dr. Charles Root, who will be speaking on behalf of, he's taking Dr. Clarke's place, who could not make it. And they are representing the American Association for Clinical Chemistry.
You want to move around and use that one, or that's stationary? Okay, we're not going to use them anyway. Good morning, and again, my name is Charles Root, and I am CEO of CodeMap, and I'm here to represent the American Association of Clinical Chemists. AACC is a global scientific and medical organization that is dedicated to clinical laboratory science and healthcare. Obviously, we work to advance the common interests in the field, providing programs that advance scientific collaboration, knowledge, expertise, and innovation. We're pleased to provide some feedback on the crosswalks. As with the previous speaker, I'm going to try to be very brief because all of the detail has been submitted and will be available from Glenn in electronic format. Very briefly, on the crosswalks that we do recommend, on the obstetric panel, we believe it should simply be crosswalk to the component tests, including the HIV. So essentially the same recommendation. In terms of hepatitis C antibody screening, it should go to 86803, which is simply hepatitis C antibody, because that is a direct crosswalk to exactly the same test. Going on to the MAAA codes, in general, we have tried to crosswalk these, our recommendations, to the component codes that are required to use the algorithm that's associated. On the first one, which is for autoimmune rheumatoid arthritis, 815XL, we'd crosswalk that, for example, to 12 times 83520, which is the amino assay not otherwise specified, because it contains 12 biomarkers that are essentially amino assays. And the basis for this is that is typically how most payers reimburse these type codes when they do pay for them. The next three codes for coronary artery disease, oncology, colon oncology, and colorectal screening. Likewise, in this case, we propose to crosswalk them to 81292, which is MLHI gene analysis. And again, we're using this as an index code, which generally represents other assays that are very similar. On the next two codes for gynecologic oncology, we have no comment. The 815XL oncology lung, which is a mass spectrometric 8-protein signature procedure, we recommend crosswalking to 83789 mass spectrometry and tandem mass spectrometry. The next two codes, the 815XN, tumor of unknown origin, and also the thyroid oncology, we would crosswalk both of those to 81244, which is a BRCA1 gene analysis. And again, these are very similar in resource utilization to that code. The next one for cardiology, heart transplant, would go to 81292, again, the MLHI gene. We have no comment on the next code. On the oncology high-grade prostate cancer,
We would crosswalk to a combination of PSA and two times free PSA and an immunoassay, again on the basis that these are the component tests that the algorithm relies on. In terms of reconsideration requests, on the Cologuard, we believe they should retain the existing reimbursement amount. And then lastly, on the 81246 through 81313 reconsiderations, we have no comment. We'd like to make a further general comment on the drug testing codes. AACC recommends that the proposed HCPCS codes should not be adopted. The approach simply does not allow for reporting of individual drugs and consequently makes it very difficult to apply coverage policy and medical necessity determinations. We actually do recommend that CMS should seriously consider adopting the existing CPT codes, since these do exactly define what tests are performed. They have a good background of guidance in the CPT, and we feel are much superior to the existing set of G codes. In terms of molecular pathology codes, the basis here, we believe these should be crosswalked. I think we should quit using the gap-filling technique, since we now have a number of gene and other codes that have been priced, and use the much more efficient crosswalking methodology. And again, we plan to submit further comments on this during the two-week period in detail on some of these codes. Thank you very much.
Questions or comments?
Hi, Edith Hambrick, CMS. I just had a question in general about the crosswalks 81292 and 81244. Unfortunately, I don't have the full descriptor in front of me, but this will be sort of a general question. So for on the first page, the ones that you say to crosswalk to 81292, and you said you're going to explain this a little bit more, is it because of the number of genes or markers that are being tested which made you pick 81292 versus 81244? Obviously, the 81244 ones you've recommended have like 92 genes or 142 genes. So a little bit about how you selected the code, since I don't have the code descriptors for, you know, those codes.
We actually relied on AMP's recommendations almost exclusively in picking most of these codes, and I believe that's primarily what they did as well. As you know, they've submitted detailed analysis of what are proper crosswalks. So we really defer to their judgment, since they're the real experts in this area.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Yes. Thank you. Our fifth speaker, Dr. Walker, has stated that basically her presentation is a comment, and she won't be speaking here, but if you wish to see her comment, please send me an email and I can send you what she had submitted, okay, along with all the other comments and presentations as well, okay? So we move to our sixth speaker, who is Eric Zimmerman for John Warren of McDermott Consulting, as well as Coalition for 21st Century Medicine.
How do I get it blend to the, this is just the chart. Do you have the, maybe the presentation is loaded next? Is that possible? We submitted two documents, a chart and a slide deck. Maybe that's it, yeah. Yeah, that's it, perfect. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Eric Zimmerman, on behalf of the Coalition for 21st Century Medicine. Coalition represents clinical labs and investors who develop and commercialize state-of-the-art diagnostics that have substantially improved patient health and advanced diagnostics. On this slide, you see a representation of the participants in the Coalition for 21st Century Medicine. Today, on behalf of the Coalition, we want to address two issues. First, the genomic sequencing procedures that are up for reconsideration this year. And with respect to the genomic sequencing procedures, we want to again encourage CMS to allow the MACs to price these procedures on the local level, at the local level, through a gap fill technique. The codes that are represented here are of a non-specific, undefined nature. It's challenging to map the code to a specific test, and that positions the local contractors, the MACs, to most effectively engage in a dialogue with the labs that are in their jurisdiction, understand what the test is, what's involved, and to establish a price for that test, establish both coverage and a price. Gap fill is the technique that is most appropriate for these services because there are no analogs for them in the CLFS, so no ability, no effective ability to crosswalk for these services. Finally, we encourage CMS to continue to allow the MACs to use unique identifiers for these tests so that both CMS and the MACs have clarity as to what they're paying for. With respect to the second comment, we want to talk about the MA codes, and I'll disagree with the previous speaker and talk a little bit about how these codes came to be on the public meeting CLFS list this year, and how we recommend, how the Coalition recommends that CMS handle these codes. These codes are all considered advanced diagnostic laboratory tests under the definitions established by PAMA that Mark was talking about previously, and we have previously talked with CMS about what we believe was Congress's vision and intent with respect to these codes moving forward, how they should be priced for 2016 in advance of PAMA. When PAMA was enacted, there was a dynamic ongoing where you had a series of advanced diagnostic tests that already were covered by Medicare, already were being paid for by Medicare, but did not have codes associated with them. So PAMA established special rules for existing advanced diagnostic laboratory tests whereby they would get codes and be put into a position in advance of PAMA's effective date in 2017 to be able to report data into the portal and then be appropriately priced going forward in 2017. Now there's three specific provisions in PAMA that I want to talk about that I think guide the analysis here. First of all is the definition in subsection E regarding advanced or applicable to advanced diagnostic lab tests. As you can see from the definition here, there's a couple of key criteria offered by a single laboratory and a unique algorithm that analyzes multiple biomarkers. The eight tests that are represented by nine codes that are on the list under MAS are all ADLTs. As I mentioned, there was a process put in place in PAMA, in section 216, that ensured that these tests that were already being covered by Medicare, already paid for by Medicare, already widely utilized both by private payer, patients around the country through private plans as well as Medicare beneficiaries through Medicare, would be able to get codes so that they could then report into report data into CMS and be priced for 2017. The provision that enabled this was subsection E2, which defined exactly this category of tests. These are tests for which payment is already made by Medicare, but which do not have a code. And that's exactly the situation that these tests were in on the date of enactment, April 1st of 2014. So tests that meet the criteria of this subsection E5 were excuse me, E2, were directing, CMS was directed per this provision to assign a unique code for these services and then to publicly report the rate that was already being paid, that was already established per the gap fill procedures or whatever methodology that these tests had gone through with their local MACs. To fulfill on this obligation, the American Medical Association, CPT, set up an expedited process to assign codes for these tests in advance of 2016. AMA set up this process a year ago, in the fall, and the tests, eight tests applied for these codes and were given codes in March of this year, and again, to position them to be able to report going forward in 2017, or 2016 for pricing in 2017. Now, not surprisingly, because these were new codes, CMS put them on the list and followed the procedures that it has traditionally followed when new codes are established by the AMA. But if CMS follows the typical process that it traditionally does when it has new codes coming forward, you've got two dynamics that are going to happen. First of all, if it follows the path that it has traditionally followed for these tests, which is to gap fill, then it can't fulfill on the obligation of having a payment rate reported by January 1 of 2016, because those processes typically take longer and would go beyond and well into 2016. Moreover, and I think most importantly for both CMS, the MACs that would be involved, as well as the developers of these tests, you're creating a great deal of unnecessary work for everybody involved, because you would be going through a gap fill process when you already have a payment rate that has been established pursuant to something akin to a gap fill process, only to have that price become effective at about the same time that CMS will start to implement on PAMA and have market-based payment rates in January of 2017. So you're essentially creating an absurd result where there's a tremendous amount of work by all involved with really no purpose at the end. Now, in conversations with CMS, we understand that there's a challenge to reconcile the provisions that I've previously talked about with respect to defining ADLTs and the existing ADLTs, and then the transition rule. Transition rule in subsection I of the statute does speak to CMS continuing the process until PAMA, the PAMA process of reporting and basing payment on market rates becomes effective in 2017. And under the transition rule, CMS is instructed to continue to use the methodologies that were in effect before enactment of the act, which it may include crosswalking and gap fill. Now, our understanding of having been there at the creation and understanding how these different provisions were intended to be working and working in harmony was that the transition rule was intended to provide CMS or to instruct CMS with how to price new tests that would come along, not to go through an exercise of repricing existing ADLTs for which Medicare already covers them and already has established a payment rate. And so to read these two provisions in harmony, in concert, we would assert that the transition rule is intended to clarify how CMS is to move forward with respect to new tests that come on the market, not just new codes, but new tests that haven't previously been covered or paid for by Medicare. So I see the enforcer here, and I'll quickly wrap up. Our recommendations, therefore, with respect to the MAS are that by January 16, CMS should adopt the nine codes that were established through AMA CPT, that CMS price these codes pursuant to the prices that have already been established by the MACs, that are already in place, that Medicare already uses, that CMS report and publish those payment rates, which would be consistent with the existing ADLT section, and that CMS continue to keep those rates in effect until January 17, when it implements the market-based payment. With that, I'd be delighted to take a question. Dr. Farrell.
So if I understand your original recommendation is that we should use gap filling for the genomic sequencing procedures. While most of us feel that the gap filling process is an interminable process, eventually you end up with some NLA. So at what point in time would you recommend that those NLAs become crosswalkable values versus continuing to gap fill all the new ones that come in?
Well, what I would say with respect to those tests is that continue to gap fill at the local level. That's the process that is most appropriate for those tests. And then we will have a PAMA process in place that will replace that and specifies how the payment is to be established.
So you don't believe that there will ever be a gap-filled NLA amount that can be crosswalked to? It'll be replaced by the new PAMA price?
Replaced by the new PAMA price. Now it's my turn. Now I get to turn it back.
I'm in charge.
No doubt about that.
So on your last slide, you had suggested that we continue to pay the current rate for the tests that you believe are ADLTs, that would meet the statutory definition of an ADLT. Irrespective of whether the rule had been published by this time and the criteria for ADLT were well known and people were able to apply, under prior policy, our two statutory basis for pricing or statutory regulatory basis, really regulatory, I guess, for basis for pricing were crosswalking and gap filling. Going forward, it's going to be the median of the private payer rates, actual list charge, beginning on or after January 1st, 2017, or crosswalking or gap filling. So what would the statutory basis or the legal basis for paying what the current rates are that you are suggesting that we pay?
Existing ADLTs, and that's the distinction that I'm making, Mark, that the transition rule does say continue to use the processes you've used, as you said, gap filling and crosswalk, but that was intended to be used for new tests, not new codes, that already had prices, already had coverage under Medicare, that the existing ADLT provision has to have meaning. You have to read these two together and understand how they relate, and you have to give some credit to existing ADLTs. And really the only way that you can do that is understanding that what existing ADLT provision was intending to do was say, all right, give these tests that already have payment amounts, already have coverage, give them a code, and then just report that payment amount that already has been established through a great deal of work on the part of the labs and on part of the MACs, and report that for 2016. Then of course, by 2017, you've got the PAMA process that takes place, but the transition rule and the gap fill and crosswalk is essentially superseded by that. That's the new statutory basis, the new statutory authority.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Michael McEachin of the College of American Pathologists.
Good morning. My name is Michael McEachin. I'm chair of the Department of Pathology at Piedmont Noonan Hospital in Noonan, Georgia. I also serve as the CPT advisor and head of the CPT RUC subcommittee for the College of American Pathologists Economic Affairs Committee. I'm here today to present recommendations on behalf of the college regarding payment for the new CPT codes for consideration in the 2016 Medicare Clinical Laboratory Fee Schedule. In December of 2014, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services issued a final payment determination for new codes for the 2015 Clinical Laboratory Fee Schedule. Following careful review of the final determinations, the College of American Pathologists requests reconsideration of the basis for payment of the new Tier 1 Molecular Pathology CPT codes and the new genomic sequencing procedures, CPG codes. We believe additional stakeholder input through the annual CLFS public meeting process would allow additional clarification regarding typical resources required to perform and the clinical uses for these services, as well as the manner in which the technology typically associated with these services compares and or contrasts to the typical technology associated with existing services paid on the clinical laboratory fee schedule. The College of American Pathologists remains concerned with regard to transparency issues associated with the gap fill process for the molecular pathology and genomic sequencing codes. As a result, we believe that crosswalk methodology should be used to determine comparable resources associated with the new and revised genomic sequencing procedures and molecular pathology CPT codes to support implementation of these new codes by Medicare and other payers for the 2016 calendar year. Many services within the molecular pathology subsection and genomic sequencing procedure subsection of the CPT require similar resources and use comparable technologies which are directly applicable for crosswalk valuation. A chart with our updated crosswalk recommendations was submitted to CMS, and a copy of these crosswalks can be found on the table outside the room. As private payers often use Medicare clinical laboratory fee schedule national limitation amounts as a factor in determining payment for these services provided to private payer beneficiaries, we believe it's important for CMS to use the transparent nature of the annual public meeting process to discuss and make preliminary payment determinations using crosswalk methodologies for new codes to facilitate patient understanding and to access to laboratory tests and technologies adopted for clinical use. In the 2015 clinical laboratory fee schedule final determinations, the agency demonstrates its willingness to work with stakeholders to establish national pricing for a CLFS test using crosswalks to existing molecular pathology codes, such as 81275 and 81375, as noted by HCPCS code G0464, which was the colorectal cancer screening, stool-based DNA, and fecal occult hemoglobin. For 2016, we hope the agency will use this public meeting process and the subsequent comment period to work with other molecular stakeholders and provide and develop national pricing for new and reconsidered molecular pathology Tier 1 and genomic sequencing CPT codes. The CAP welcomes further dialogue with CMS officials regarding the resources necessary to perform and the clinical uses of the molecular pathology and genomic sequencing procedures provided to Medicare and Medicaid beneficiaries. Again, we thank you for the opportunity for the College of American Pathologists to make clinical laboratory fee schedule payment recommendations for these new codes. Thank you.
Any questions or comments?
All right, I'm a little confused. You submitted a presentation in which you had the codes listed and only five recommendations, nine recommendations. And the rest of it said see handout. Now, I might assume that the handout is something that's out here.
Yes.
It's not something that you submitted.
Our handout was submitted on the table.
It's not something that you submitted prior to this meeting.
I'm unclear as to exactly. Can someone, Anna? I'm unclear as to the exact nature of which handout you're referring to. We have a handout on the table which is printed out with our...
Well, what you have presented, if you'll go to page 7, 8, or 9. So the rest of the presentation says see handout.
Yeah.
And so
we just updated them so that you can...
So this has all of your recommendations in?
Yes, we can submit it electronic if you prefer that.
All right. Thank you.
Sorry for the confusion.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Aaron Bossler of the of the Association for Molecular Pathology.
Do you have all my slides?
All the ones that you sent?
Submitted, yep. That's for
okay. Can you use that to move around the stationary, same thing?
Good morning. Hi, I'm Aaron Bossler, Director of the Molecular Pathology Laboratory at the University of Iowa and Chair of the AMP Economic Affairs Committee. The Association for Molecular Pathology is a professional, not-for-profit scientific society that advances the clinical practice, science, and excellence of molecular and genomic laboratory medicine. We're very grateful for the opportunity to recommend crosswalks, we know how important national pricing is to providing direction to Medicare contractors, but it's also an important basis for Medicare, Medicaid, and other healthcare payers. Our recommendations are listed in detail in the subsequent slides, but for the sake of time, I'll only highlight the basis for these recommendations, starting with the 2016 CLFS Molecular Pathology Tier 1 procedures and the Tier 1 procedures from the 2015 reconsideration. And then I'll go into more detail about the genomic sequencing procedures, both those under reconsideration for 2015 and also those for 2016, because of the use of a similar rationale, which I'll explain in detail. So the basis for the recommendations for the Tier 1 molecular pathology procedures is on the amount of genetic material being interrogated and reported on. So with our first example here, 81276, this is for KRAS mutation testing for additional variants, codon 61 and codon 146. These are important to identify in patients with colorectal cancer, as the presence of the mutations is a contraindication for targeted anti-EGFR monoclonal antibody therapy. The methods that are used are typically PCR-based, and the resource utilization is very similar to what's used for the parent code 81275, KRAS gene analysis, variants in codons 12 and 13. So our recommendation is to crosswalk to code 81275. As you'll see through the rest of our recommendations with regards to the Tier 1 molecular codes, it's based on the similar amount of genetic material and the similar methods that are used for testing. So for the sake of time, I'm not going to go into those in any great detail. This rationale also applies to the molecular pathology Tier 1 codes that are under reconsideration from last year. And again, the crosswalks were similarly chosen because they require similar levels of resource utilization and either the same number of variants or similar RNA expression analysis, depending on the code. And so this applies to codes 81246, 81313, 81288, and 81287. So moving on to the genomic sequencing procedures, we first want to show you cost data that we collected from laboratories to help demonstrate the actual costs of performing these tests. We think this is invaluable to understanding the basis for our recommendations. And then I'll go through our crosswalk recommendations, highlighting the formula that we derived for determining the relativity. So AMP performed cost analyses of the three following assays here, 81415 for exome sequence analysis, 81430 for hearing loss, multi-gene panel, and the 81445 targeted genomic sequence analysis panel for solid organ neoplasms. The method that we used was similar to the process that's used for determining the practice expense for codes that are listed on the physician fee schedule. So we went through the microcosting exercise to really determine what the cost of these codes were. And we thought that this was important because the complexity of this testing is pretty considerable. And there's also considerable variability in what laboratories have available to them to perform the testing. So we wanted to make sure that we were identifying the cost of the consumables and the supplies for those laboratories, the equipment that they were using, in particular the bioinformatics and the reporting of these procedures, because the cost of developing these bioinformatic pipelines, the curation of the results, and the reporting of the results is much more labor involved and requires higher skilled labor. We also identified the personnel time, or the hands-on time by the laboratory personnel, and then also identified the validation and maintenance costs. We had a challenge in trying to determine overhead costs, so those are actually not included in our microcosting. So this is a representative table. I know it's very difficult to read, of the five laboratories that provided data to us with regards to testing that they performed that would fulfill the criteria for 81445 targeted genomic sequence analysis, solid organ neoplasm, 5 to 50 genes. As you can see here on the left-hand side, I guess I don't have a pointer, but we broke these things down into the total labor time, the consumable costs, the equipment costs, the informatics labor costs, and the bioinformatics data analysis and reporting costs so that we could come up with a total cost. And you can see that there's a little bit of variability in these numbers in each of these individual components, but overall, the cost range was from $578 to $908 for these five specific laboratories. And what we saw is that the cost variation was due primarily to things like library preparation and sequencing. There's different methods that people can use for doing that. The degree to which they invested in lab-developed or commercial bioinformatic pipeline analysis, and the cost of their validations. Most of the assays were based on commercial mutation panels from the two primary manufacturers, but we're also seeing, at least within the industry, a much greater variety of testing that's come on board since we've done the cost analysis. Moving on to 81430 for hearing loss, there were two laboratories that provided cost results for us here. And overall, these two laboratories were providing almost identical sets of genes, which I think helps account for why the costs were so similar here, $1,890 or $1,949. The largest variance in cost was at the technical sequencing and bioinformatic analysis components. And lastly, we had three laboratories that provided their cost data for exome sequencing code 81415. Where we saw some greater variability here from around $1,600 up to $3,100. Some of this variability was due to the fact that the lowest cost assay had some of the least data analysis expense due to highly automating their system, making it a more efficient data analysis. And the highest cost assay had much more manual labor involved in the data analysis. So we use this kind of as a basis to provide some transparency with regards to the costs of actually performing this testing by the laboratories. And all of this information is available, publicly available on the AMP website. So let me move on to our crosswalk recommendations. So the crosswalks for the genomic sequencing procedures are based on the relativity and similarity of resources to the tier one molecular pathology procedure. And I think this will get a little bit at Dr. Hambrick's question from earlier. So there are codes for performing gene sequencing that have been priced on the tier one molecular pathology procedures. We felt that the most representative of these is 81292 for MLH1. It's commonly performed and it has a representative number of exons, 21 exons for that particular gene. So the first component of this kind of three-component analysis that we formula that we came up with for the crosswalk recommendations was first to compare traditional Sanger sequencing to that of genomic sequencing procedures. And we know that there's a significant cost savings in doing genomic sequencing procedures using next-gen sequencing. And we determined that there was approximately 1/5 or 20% of the cost for doing Sanger sequencing. So that's the first component of the formula that we used in determining the pricing. The second component is that genomic sequencing procedures require a much greater amount of bioinformatic analysis that isn't common for traditional Sanger sequencing. There's a lot more data there to analyze, and you need to have more sophisticated programs to do that. So this is where we recommend the inclusion of code 87901. It's the only code that involves genotypic bioinformatics, and this is for HIV infectious agent drug susceptibility. So if we apply that to one of the codes that's under reconsideration, 81410 for aortic dysfunction, which requires sequencing of at least 9 genes. Those 9 genes have 240 exons. I did the math for that. If we take 20% of that, 1/5, that's 48 exons. This is approximately 2 times the number of exons for the MLH1 gene, had 21, in code 81292. So given this relationship and the two components that I just explained to you, we recommend a crosswalk to 81292 and 87901, both of those times two. Now the third component of this, if you stick with me here, the math geek in me comes out. We realized that this was going to be a bit cumbersome to try to be calculating the number of exons for all of these assays. So we moved to genes, and if we take the natural log using 81410 for aortic dissection of nine genes, the natural log of that is 2.19, almost identical to the multiple that we were recommending based on the number of exons. So that's the third component of our formula here for determining the crosswalk recommendation. So if we move on to code 81430 for hearing loss, this has a minimum of 60 genes. The natural log of that is around 4. So our crosswalk recommendation is to 81292 and 87901 times 4. So the relativity is based on the minimum number of genes using the application of the natural log of the number of genes to determine the multiple using 81292 and 87901 for all of the rest of the genomic sequencing procedures that involve sequence analysis, including exome analysis, 81415, approximately 20,000 genes, so natural log of about 9.9, 81435, 81440, 81460, 81470, you can see the genes and the multiplier there, and then also 81445, 81450, and 81455, using an average number of genes from the 5 to 50, so where we get the 27, and taking the natural log of that to get the multiplier. Moving on to the duplication deletion analysis codes. So these are also listed under the genomic sequencing procedures. Let me step back here. And so instead of using 81292, which is the sequencing of MLH1, we took the deletion duplication code for MLH1, 81294, and used that as the base and the logarithmic scale to determine the multiplier for each of the deletion duplication codes that are in the genomic sequencing procedures. So code 81411, this is duplication deletion analysis for TGF-beta-R1, R2, MYHN11, COL3A1. So a minimum of 4 genes here. Take the natural log of that, the multiplier is 1.4. So on and so forth for 81431, 81436, 81465, 81471. We also applied this rationale to the codes that were being considered for at this meeting for the 2016 publication. So we appreciate the opportunity to provide crosswalk recommendations to CMS, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Edith Hambrick, CMS.
Hi, Edith.
So for BRCA, I think I'm correct, and I'm sure you'll correct me if I'm wrong. There are two different ways, at least that I've heard you can do it. You can do it the traditional, let's call it, from the first part of your slide where you're asking for us to price it at 81211 and 81213. You could also do it by genomic sequencing. Is that correct? That's the first question, because I make sure I'm in the right ballpark first.
Yes, that is correct, and there are laboratories that are doing it both ways.
Right. And so is it AMP's position that depending on the methodology that's used, that's how they should be priced, even though one might be significantly cheaper than the other?
Generally, we would agree with that. I don't know that we haven't created a specific BRCA code. There are the hereditary codes that would include BRCA sequencing for breast and ovarian cancer.
Okay. And then my next question is about how the bioinformatics data analysis reporting costs are determined, and maybe you may or may not be able to speak to that because you obviously talked to different labs about that, and they may have just given you a cost. But if you could speak in general about how that happens, or later on offline about how that happens, if you know, and what types of things tend to be in here. That tends to be a black box. People just say, it cost me $15 million to do it, and I broke it down by how many tests I think I'm gonna have now, and therefore, give me $500 for my bioinformatics.
So we certainly understand the concern, and we'd be more than happy to talk to you offline to go into those details. We were actually very detailed in that analysis because we also wanted to understand what laboratories were doing. And so there's very detailed spreadsheets that we went through to identify each of the individual components, the hands-on time that was involved there, any of the products that they purchased off the shelf, or if they had a software designer or bioinformatician who developed the software for them, in the amount of time that it took to do that. We do have very detailed information on how that breaks down.
Thanks.
Yep, you're welcome.
Oh, for the good old days of a simple crosswalk.
Yes.
For your genomic sequencing, you're recommending multiples of two codes, and you chose the 87901
yes.
because it includes the bioinformatics stuff. Is it your assumption or suggestion that all it does in that code is bioinformatics and there's not additional work done in that additional work? And if it is, that additional work is not separate, that additional work is separate and distinct from the work that's done in the 81292?
So if I can paraphrase your question a little bit here, I think what you're asking me is there duplication of service that's performed with 87901? And there possibly is some overlap there in the sequencing that's performed. But there are no other bioinformatics codes that address the component of analyzing the data and comparing it to a database to help determine sequence alignment and the importance of particular variants. So all of these are somewhat fractional because of the multiplier and the much greater amount of data that's being generated with the genomic sequencing procedures. So in general, I don't think that there is a duplication of service. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Paul Sheives, and if I got your name wrong, I'm sorry, of the American Clinical Laboratory Association.
Good morning. My name is Paul Sheives, and I'm here presenting on behalf of the members of the American Clinical Laboratory Association. I wanted to thank CMS for the opportunity to provide comments today. Aaron's a tough act to follow. I don't have any natural logs in my presentation, so I hope my single-digit integers keep you awake. First topic I wanted to cover today was CMS's proposal, encoding proposal, and for payment on drug of abuse testing. This slide kind of walks through the long history of drugs of abuse testing coding, and I'm not going to belabor the point too much, but really the take-home message here is that there's a long history of coding surrounding this testing, and it reflects the complexity in trying to establish appropriate codes. Most recently, CMS declined to implement the 64 CPT codes and also to delete the current G codes. And under CMS's proposal, it would replace all of the existing codes with two codes, one for screening and one for definitive testing. At the outset, I wanted to say CLA supports the need for clear coding and billing requirements to reduce unnecessary and inappropriate utilization of drugs of abuse testing. We are committed to working with CMS to establish coding that allows for adequate and appropriate reimbursement for these tests. The two-code and associated payment level type of approach proposed by CMS, though, fails to differentiate among variable resources required or different methods performed in the course of legitimate and medically necessary testing. In response to CMS's proposal, we formed an internal working group at ACLA and tried to come up with payment recommendations that would result in adequate and appropriate payments for these tests. And we found that was not possible to provide a viable payment recommendation based on only two codes. Any approach we looked at to that would significantly overpay or underpay for important testing. Also, with regard to screening codes, we really believe that the term presumptive should be used by CMS, and that's because laboratories don't really have a way to tell why the test is being done and that it is for a screening purpose. And rather, the underlying technology is really based on making a presumptive determination. In the letter we provided to CMS on July 1st, which we provided copies of outside, it's also on our website if you'd like to download it there if you didn't get a copy today. We laid out the differences between screening and presumptive testing and confirmatory or definitive testing. We discussed various clinical uses of these tests in the clinical setting and provided a more detailed justification for why a more granular approach to coding for drug abuse testing is necessary. I'm not going to get into that level of detail here and would refer you to the letter, but what you can see here on the slide is that our recommendation for both coding and payment for the presumptive testing. We recommend two codes. So one would be based on really relatively more simple testing methodologies, many of which are wave tests, and we recommend just crosswalking to the existing code GO434 at a rate of $19. For the more sophisticated immunoassays that are more expensive to perform because they have different inputs and are run on more sophisticated and costly instruments, we recommend crosswalking them to the GO431 at a price of $98.96. Much of the same rationale for the need for multiple codes for presumptive tests also applies to definitive testing. Here again on terminology, we really think the term confirmatory testing is not appropriate, and it should be definitive because that's really what the technology is getting to. An independent lab may not have the information as to why the test is being done or that a previous test was done, so confirmatory may not be the right term there. Multiple codes are necessary because when one performs liquid chromatography mass spectrometry to test for the definitive presence of numerous drugs, it's generally necessary to do several separate runs on the instrument. As the specimen is tested for a higher number of drugs, the likelihood that some additional specimen preparation will be necessary increases. And as a result, so does the likelihood that additional runs on the LCMS instrument will be required. So obviously, additional runs are more expensive because they require additional resources and staff time to administer and monitor the testing. And this is why it's really inappropriate to have a single code for all definitive testing. So the approach that we recommend here is really based on what is going on in Palmetto's jurisdiction and under their policy. Here is a tiered approach for four codes based on the number of drugs. The only difference that we had is that I think Palmetto actually teases out each individual drugs when they're between 1 and 7, where we have grouped them together. And so you can see the prices on the right, the bottom three are based on what Palmetto was paying and then just extended linearly for the bottom, or for the G05 code. Another topic that I wanted to cover in our oral comments is payment for the set of 8 existing ADLTs under PAMA. These comments follow closely what Eric Zimmerman presented earlier, so I won't belabor them too much, but just to walk through that once again. There were 9 MAW codes that were assigned test-specific Category 1 CPT codes through the existing ADLT process established by the AMA to support the implementation of PAMA 216. And under the existing ADLTs are defined as those sole source MAAA tests that had Medicare coverage and established payment rate at their local Medicare contractor for their jurisdiction as of April 1st, 2014. PAMA requires that these prices for these existing ADLTs be published by January 1st, 2016. And historically, CMS has issued determinations for sole source MAAAs or ADLTs to set payment based on the price established by the Medicare contractor that processes the claim for that test, as they are sole source. ACLA recommends that CMS publish the existing ADLT price set by the local contractor as of April 1st, 2014, consistent with PAMA. The Medicare contractors of jurisdiction and their assigned rates are provided for each test and their MAW codes in the following slides. I won't run through these slides, but they reflect this approach and the price that each existing ADLT was paid by the respective local contractor as of April 1st, 2014. And we believe that these ADLTs should be priced at these rates. Finally, the following three slides present our recommendations for many of the remaining codes. Notably, we have withheld comment at this time on the genomic sequencing procedure codes, as well as most of the reconsideration requests. We will provide to CMS in written comment period following this meeting comments on those remaining codes. So the first two of the codes were just administrative MAAAs, and thus, of course, we don't have any payment recommendation. With regard to the Cologuard test, which was discussed earlier this morning, we felt the payment rate was done sufficiently during the process where it was established for the G code, and strongly believe that ACLA should they should crosswalk to the G code G0464 for oncology colorectal screening. So similar to a recommendation made earlier on the obstetric panel with HIV, the current obstetric panel is not in the clinical lab fee schedule, but we recommend the sum of the performed procedures and the existing CPT components should be used for the pricing, and so we're recommending a crosswalk of 80055 plus 87389. With respect to the Hep C antibody screening, we have, just based on similar resources, and should be crosswalked to the same code on the same laboratory procedure that is performed, is 86803 at $19.42. Finally, the additional BRCA code was created here really to accommodate the way for new market entrants to provide BRCA testing while remaining aligned with NCCN and societal guidelines for those determined to be high risk. And similar to the other recommendations, most of which we've heard here today, we really suggest just crosswalking to the components of that, which are 81211 for your most common dupe dels, and for the uncommons to 81213. With respect to HIT, we recommend crosswalking to the JAK2 V617F variant. They're similar single variant gene analysis assays, and use similar resources. And finally, with regarding KRAS, we suggest crosswalking to the existing KRAS gene analysis procedure, CPT 81275. The new CPT was assigned for the same KRAS procedure that is currently coded as Tier 2, 81403, in 2015. So that concludes our presentation. I'm happy to take any questions. And again, for the remaining codes, we'll be following up with written comments to CMS prior to August 6th.
Our next presenters are Shannon Curtis and Sylvia Trujillo of the American Medical Association.
I'm Shannon Curtis, and on behalf of our physician and medical student members, the American Medical Association appreciates the opportunity to provide comments regarding the new clinical diagnostic laboratory test codes for the clinical laboratory fee schedule for calendar year 2016. The AMA shares CMS's goal of ensuring that Medicare beneficiaries receive quality clinical testing services when they are required, while safeguarding against inappropriate utilization. This area of medicine is undergoing significant change and growth. Notably, from 2005 to 2010, Part B Medicare enrollment increased by 10%, yet spending for clinical laboratory testing services increased by 29%, according to a recent report of the OIG. While such rapid growth has heightened interest in addressing utilization, quality testing, and program integrity, the growth also reflects some of the most exciting and innovative changes in clinical practice driven by new procedures, methods, and technologies that guide and support clinical decision-making and are transforming patient care. Because physicians on a regular basis incorporate clinical testing results in their assessment of the appropriate management of a patient's medical care, policies in this area of medical practice, though constituting a relatively small percentage of overall Medicare expenditures, have an outsized impact on Medicare beneficiary care. The AMA is concerned when significant alterations in coverage, pricing, and coding policies are implemented with very limited advance notice and often with little to no input from a large number of impacted stakeholders that are engaged in the delivery of patient care. The foregoing, coupled with the forthcoming new policies required as part of the Protecting Access to Medicare Act, could compromise patient access and further limit the ability of physicians, both treating physicians and clinical laboratory physicians, to provide medically necessary and reasonable clinical care. In the past, clinical laboratory policy changes have been confusing, often arbitrary, involved very limited stakeholder engagement, offered no transparency, and have been difficult to reconcile with practices and policies of other payers, including, at times, Medicare contractors that continue to follow established policies, regulations, and laws. The agency's efforts to experiment with new policies in the clinical laboratory space have evolved from being limited in scope and impact for the purposes of gathering essential information into de facto national policies without adequate notice, input, or ability to appeal or challenge material policy changes. While the AMA does not typically provide specific pricing information for services and procedures on the Medicare CLFS, we are concerned that CMS's use of the gap-fill method for pricing services and procedures on this fee schedule has created access barriers to vulnerable patient populations and has inadvertently led to revocation of coverage by other payers. We urge CMS to clearly identify the methodology and data collection practices of each Medicare contractor until PAMA pricing policies and practices are implemented. In addition, we strongly urge CMS to communicate forthcoming changes in Medicare pricing that are required by PAMA to state Medicaid programs to avoid similar disruption to patient access that was precipitated by the previous molecular pathology pricing exercise involving the gap-fill method. There is also growing confusion among providers and clearinghouses as to the appropriate codes for services and procedures on the Medicare clinical laboratory fee schedule. Providers and clearinghouses are using CPT codes for private payers, while Medicare contractors are directing providers and clearinghouses to use alternative hybrid coding for the same services and procedures, initially for molecular pathology service and procedure codes, but more recently for testing services and procedures for drugs of abuse. This creates significant additional administrative burdens for providers and creates claims processing and coding challenges when Medicare is the secondary payer. The expansion of this practice of using local codes by Medicare contractors undermines a national infrastructure relied upon by other major healthcare stakeholders, including other payers and clearinghouses, all of whom have participated in the CPT editorial panel stakeholder meetings and deliberations to develop codes that reflect broad consensus. The CPT editorial panel process is consistent with congressional intention that electronic claims be processed in an administratively simplified fashion. The AMA is interested in exploring strategies, engagement, solutions to obviate the need for local code development by individual Medicare contractors. CMS proposes to continue to not recognize CPT codes 80300 through 80377 for drugs of abuse testing services, and instead proposes two new Medicare G codes to be used to bill for drug screening and drug testing for any number of drugs or drug classes, any procedure or methodology, and any source per day. The AMA strongly urges CMS to recognize CPT codes 80300 through 80377. In addition, the AMA invites CMS to engage with stakeholders to work through the CPT editorial panel process to identify any needed modifications to the codes 80300 and 80377. I'm also going to turn it over to Sylvia Trujillo for additional comment.
Thank you, Shannon. We appreciate this opportunity. In addition to the comments today, we will be submitting some supplemental expanded comments, both on issues raised today through our fellow commenters, but to augment the comments provided by Shannon, two additional points we'd like to make. First, we appreciate the efforts of the stakeholders to develop a resolution to the challenges created by not utilizing the CPT codes related to testing for drugs of abuse. We would strongly emphasize that any alternative solution than that which is provided vis-a-vis the CPT codes is very problematic, both with regard to what private payers need to utilize, but also for purposes of further efforts to move to an alternative payment models which largely rely on clean data. Clean data is not possible or viable when you're talking about multiple code sets being used by multiple payers. So one of our strong recommendations to the agency, not simply with regard to the CLFS, but more broadly for purposes of transitioning to alternative payment models, is a need for transparency, consistency, and the ability for stakeholders to be engaged in the process. And for that reason, we strongly urge the agency to adopt the existing CPT codes and incorporate feedback and information that they have received previously with regard to the pricing of those codes. Thank you very much.
Any questions, comments? Okay, thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Charles Root, and he will this time he'll be speaking on behalf of CodeMap.
Okay, for the encore presentation, CodeMap is a consulting company that we deal almost exclusively with laboratory coding issues and compliance issues. As such, we are in the midst of everything from denials and billing processes where people have questions to compliance and making sure that they get paid correctly and don't get overpaid and so on. This gives us somewhat of a unique position to see all of the actual results of the creation of some of these codes and what really happens when the rubber hits the road, so to speak. Our recommendations today more or less summarize our clients' positions in the area, and all I'm gonna talk about is the drug testing codes. Very simple recommendation is that the proposed two codes not be adopted. And again, the same reasons that you've already heard, setting an appropriate pricing level with only one definitive code, for example, was really almost impossible. It'll either be too low and it won't cover the costs, or it'll be too high and it'll encourage people to do the least number of drugs possible. And for example, a lot of the current problem, of course, has been driven by overutilization. And if you give people the opportunity to somehow scam the system, they always will. A good example is if you took a median price for the single code, and let's say it was $150, because that's sort of halfway between too high and too low. This is for any number of drugs per day or per patient encounter. You can see a pain practice saying, well, I think I can, I'll simply rig up a laboratory-developed immunoassay system and run alcohol on all of my clients because I'm pretty sure they all probably drink, and I qualify for the 150. So you can, I know that's a little simplistic, but this unbelievable is the way things often work out there. So saying that we don't want those two codes, we do have a proposed solution, and again, it reflects pretty much what's already been said. We believe you should delete all of the existing HCPCS G codes and simply adopt the CPT. These codes were put together with a work group that spent almost a year putting it together, hundreds of hours, and the guidance also in the CPT gives you the definitions and so on that need to go with the codes so that you can use them correctly. There's not any very little ambiguity in these codes compared to what we're currently working with. There's the other problem though then. CMS was rightly concerned that if you've got a lot of codes and each one of them has a price attached, people will tend to want to do a lot of codes to get as much money as possible. That is obviously a problem that needs to be solved. Ideally, it would be solved by very good national coverage policy. That would be one approach. But in the meantime, it can be solved in much the same manner as already been suggested. We have a little different take on it. Instead of using, for example, the four-tiered codes for definitive testing, We would propose that CMS simply come up with a crosswalked fee schedule that anytime you do more than 8 drugs, it falls to this fee schedule, which would gradually decrease the amount paid for each individual drug. This is exactly the same as the so-called automated chemistries are now paid, so that whenever you do more than a certain, well, anytime you do automated chemistries, the computers default to a given payment. You're still reporting the individual tests so that you know exactly what's being done. You can audit those results. You can apply policy. And as also was mentioned by the AMA, you want good, precise codes for data purposes so that you can track things and find out what's working and what isn't. And this can be extremely valuable in the long term. So we would propose then that you adopt the CPT codes and you establish some sort of a tiered system that is fair in reimbursement, so that if a physician wants to order 35 tests, the lab performs them, you'll get paid a reasonable amount. But you'll also know exactly what was done, and if later on that needs to be audited for compliance purposes, you've got the codes to assist you. Thank you very much. Any questions? Okay.
Our next speaker is Dr. Andrea Barthwell from Two Dreams Treatment Centers.
Good morning, I'm Andrea Barthwell. I'd like to thank the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services for the opportunity to speak to you today about the recently proposed G-code for definitive urine drug testing. I believe we've also made progress with the limitation of duplication of effort by prohibiting the use of one presumptive test to confirm another. I have over 30 years of experience in addiction medicine and currently manage Two Dreams Treatment Centers, an individualized addiction treatment program. My unique practice focuses on individuals who have had multiple treatment attempts and are deemed reluctant to recover, and those who sit at the very complicated crossroads of pain and addiction, where medication with inherent risk of dependence is prescribed to individuals chronically with an increased risk of dependence following exposure to such medications. Additionally, I serve as a consultant to the laboratory industry, primarily in areas of compliance and regulatory concerns. I'm an MROC certified medical review officer and was a member of its exam writing committee. The certification signifies added qualifications in the use and interpretation of results arising from the use of this medical diagnostic test, which in the area of addiction medicine provides an added benefit of an external locus of control until a newly recovering individual develops an internal locus of control. From 2002 to 2004, I served as Deputy Director for Demand Reduction in the Office of National Drug Control Policy, where I was responsible for advising on policies to prevent, intervene on, and treat substance use disorders. I'm also a fellow and former president of the American Society of Addiction Medicine and was invited to serve as the executive secretary for a multidisciplinary consensus process to define the use and frequency of urine drug testing in the detection and management of substance use disorders. The impetus to provide clarification to the well-recognized ASAM white paper on UDT was stimulated by the dual threats of increasing use of opioids and marijuana in an environment of increased regulatory review intended to contain costs associated with unnecessary and excessive urine drug testing. The consensus panel agreed that we are committed to employing best practices in monitoring and managing addiction treatment and support urine drug testing that simultaneously improves clinical practice and controls health care cost. We recognize improvements in the ability to detect substances in a variety of matrices, and we have carefully defined the use of this tool in clinical rather than forensic terms. I urge you to look at Palmetto GBA's tiered testing structure as a feasible approach that supports best practices in urine drug testing. Palmetto uses a model of tiered pricing and coding that limits fee-for-service testing to a certain number of drugs. Palmetto's model provides increasing reimbursement for four bundles of services, providing clinicians with the opportunity to test patients for clinically relevant medications and substances of abuse based on risk, historical use, durability of abstinence, treatment effectiveness, and notable events in the treatment milieu. Supporting a structured approach to the scope and nature of testing is important in addiction treatment because often patients withhold information about their substance use, even though the practitioner must obtain a thorough and accurate picture of that same patient's substance use in order to practice safer prescribing of controlled substances, assist in assessing medication efficacy, and to minimize drug-drug interactions. These tasks are made more difficult where pain and addiction overlap. As more and more individuals are provided access to life-improving chronic opioid therapy in offices where knowledge about how to identify and manage the consequences and complications from such exposure is limited, having access to definitive information about these hidden behaviors becomes more critical. We often note that the physician does not know what the physician does not know until testing reveals that information. The information gained is useful in crafting therapeutic responses and to discern potential drug misuse and diversion. Under the tiered system, clinicians may obtain definitive results in accordance with the patient's individual need. Tier 1 permits testing for up to 7 drugs, and prices are determined by individual drug testing codes. Tier 2 allows testing for 8 to 15 drugs at a flat rate of $180. Tier 3 permits testing for 16 to 34 drugs for approximately $215, and Tier 4 allows for testing for 35 or more drugs at a capped rate of $250. Adoption of this code will allow a laboratory to report all available information when ordered. Tier 4 is consistent with ASAM's call for smarter drug testing, in which ASAM cited a need for broad rather than targeted drug selection. When clinically indicated, Tier 4 is optimal for patients in addiction treatment. Clinicians must select substances for each patient based upon the information needed to direct care. With Tier 4, clinicians can conduct broad spectrum testing and uncover the information that patients may be withholding, thereby preventing diversion, abuse, and drug-drug interactions. I, like ACLA, support this tiered system and further encourage the adoption in conjunction with frequency of use safeguards set forth in Palmetto's Controlled Substance Monitoring and Drugs of Abuse Testing LCD. I see it as an appropriate approach to coding and pricing clinical drug testing. These safeguards include demonstrated and medical necessity and reasonable frequency of testing in patients prescribed controlled substances for pain management and those who have substance use disorders. I urge you to adopt Palmetto GBA's tiered pricing and coding structure with competitive utilization controls. Pricing should correlate with the value of the service provided to ensure that clinicians use drug testing appropriately in the treatment of their patients and valuable healthcare dollars are efficiently allocated. Thank you for your time.
Just a general comment and request on both this presentation and the ones that we're going to hear shortly. We recall earlier this morning the Mark and Eric interaction where there was a discussion of what our authorities are. We have somewhat, until PAMA arrives, somewhat limited authority as to how we establish prices in a lab setting. And the request that we came forward, and we certainly appreciate all the input as to alternatives to that, the request we came forward with was a single G code and what would be your recommendation for either crosswalking or gap filling? In the recommendations that you've provided and that I think many of the following speakers are going to provide, you're recommending a price that has been established in some manner by a contractor, but is not necessarily, unless you can explain to us how, meeting the crosswalking gap filling concept. So as you think through this and as you provide us comments later on, we need some help in determining if we were to accept the recommendation that one code is not adequate and we needed some other coding setting, under the authority that we have currently before PAMA, how do we arrive at these tiered prices?
So just to respond, this is what we have today. And I'm certain that if you were to consult with individuals in the laboratory industry, which I'm not, they would have questions as to how Palmetto established these codes and whether they looked at laboratories that work at the high end of proficiency, whether they took the recommendations of high volume, low cost laboratories in establishing these prices. And I think it all is subject to a review now before you go forward. But I cite them and encourage the looking at them because it has been adopted in one area. You may have some historical information about how that has gone. And it certainly, you would be advised to seek counsel on how it would work if laboratories that provide services across jurisdictions have to go into every jurisdiction where they operate and try to negotiate rates. So I think it's a start, and it's a start that you're going to need to work with the different jurisdictions to determine how they make a process of rate setting available and accessible. And I cite them because it's what we have. I would bet if you took a poll of people who are relying on being reimbursed for their work, that they could give you a number of indices to consider that would cause these rates to be adjusted. But I cite them because it's what we have today. And I think certainly the most complicating factor is having to have every jurisdiction negotiate rates as Palmetto did. So at least we have something to start with. Any other questions? Thank you.
Our next speaker is Dr. Carl Solavka from Atlantic Diagnostic Laboratories.
Thank you very much. To follow Dr. Barthwell, I would amplify everything that came out of her mouth, and she's not a toxicologist, so that's why she's more normal than me. We are a laboratory that does fall under the catchment of having the ability to look for a diverse number of drugs using a diverse scope of testing to best fit the individualized needs of the clinician who's trying to help people who have fallen into places that none of us want to be. But the reality is all of us could be there every day or have in the past and don't wish to return. The realities that we have to face as care provider support services in laboratories is part of what we're trying to accomplish every day in every test. And that's an individualized need, and I don't think I need to say to you that, but that's our reality. As CMS considers changes to the clinical laboratory fee schedule for 2016, all the stakeholders involved in understand the critical balance you're attempting to maintain between our nation's healthcare costs and the proper level of medical care for Americans. In this balance, we know that HHS has always leaned in favor of protecting the health and comfort of our citizens, even when the costs are a bit higher. At its core, this means that clinicians must have access to and federal support for the right tests for the right patients at the right time. I think Dr. Rudin from AACC said that best. That is the critical goal that we're trying to accomplish every day, yet we often have a dearth of information in order to help the clinicians accomplish that from a laboratory standpoint. So I think having a tiered approach, as was just discussed in depth, may be a way to get at that. Even though we recognize every patient is different, those cost containment cells of a few tests and more tests and then a cap on how many tests you could do may be the way to approach it. On October 26, 2013, the American Society of Addiction Medicine, ASAM, published their white paper that you just heard about. For the millions of addicted and drug-dependent patients, they posed the foundational goals of drug testing in a very simple manner. And since most of you, I hope, did not read it and memorize it, I thought I'd repeat this for them because it's an important place where we all start and where actually we want to finish with every patient. It is ASAM policy that the elements of drug testing, that is, the matrix, the drug testing panel, and the testing technology, be determined by the ordering physicians based on patient-specific medical necessity. Arbitrary limits on reimbursement and restrictions on drug testing can interfere with a physician's judgment and instill discriminatory limits on addiction care. We all know that CMS implements policies to reflect our federal government's concern for and agreement with this foundational principle for our most vulnerable brothers and sisters. The selection of a single type of biological sample, that is a matrix, using a single testing technology for a single limited scope of target drugs instills this discrimination and needs to be removed from our overall system. When it comes to the matrix ASAM discusses, urine drug testing has served as the major type of test employed. This is one place I'll sort of take you into a new realm perhaps, but maybe not. Drug urinalysis can absolutely discourage non-medical drug use, encourage entry into addiction treatment, and identify relapse, and it improves the outcomes through the use of long-term monitoring. But now tests on oral fluid have been demonstrated to offer a number of significant advantages in achieving these drug testing goals. Drug use insights based on oral fluid are complementary to those achieved through urinalysis, and many clinicians need the full complement of information in order to make the best healthcare choices. Unlike urine, collection of oral fluid is far less invasive and less prone to attempted adulteration. If properly collected, oral fluid samples cannot be artificially diluted to hide the recent drug use. While there are still some aspects of oral fluid testing that have not been fully defined for all applications, SAMHSA published the oral fluid mandatory guidelines in the Federal Register in May of this year. Addiction medicine specialists have been employing oral fluid tests to enhance their treatment outcomes for many years. These data sets provided by urine and oral fluid are especially complementary for patients in denial or those with special needs that may have changed from the prior clinical session. Physicians are best served by having the freedom to direct either oral fluid, urine, or both biological samples to be collected on a patient's current status and needs. Now, to avoid healthcare discrimination based on funds made available, clinicians must also be fully supported in their selection of the correct technology to employ. Point-of-care devices are based in a broad sense on similar science as that we use in the laboratory, that is immunoassays and chemical tests. But these point-of-care devices have limited scope, no quality assurance parameters built in to ensure accuracy and protect the healthcare confidentiality of the patients, and often are not sensitive to many of today's important addictive substances. Point-of-care devices have their place and should be part of the clinical toolkit for which caregivers are reimbursed, but do not have the analytical strengths, clinical power, and patient safeguards provided by lab-based screening methods. So in the discussion we just heard in the last question set, I do think that's something I hope will be seriously considered by CMS going forward. The use of laboratory-based instrumental screens must be reimbursed at a rate that is higher than POC devices. Laboratory screening is more sensitive, and routine calibration plus numerous positive and negative controls for each tested batch provide very high reliability. inclusion of sample integrity checks like creatinine and specific gravity improves the reliability of the overall process of collection. And the kits employed that define a lab's scope of drug testing can be quickly adjusted as the needs change in the community of users. Point of care devices bring with them long waiting times for any changes to be made going forward. The epidemic of prescription drug abuse that CDC announced in 2012 has also created a very different lab requirement than existed 5 years ago. CMS has long had a reimbursement rate that recognized the need for clinicians to have labs perform confirmation tests. But as you heard in the last presentation, definitive testing is really what we're after because the scope of how we test and when the tests are employed has changed over the last few years. Unfortunately, both point-of-care and laboratory-based screening tests may not detect many of the more modern benzodiazepines, opiates, and other low-dose prescription drugs that are now subject to greater potential abuse and addiction. Therefore, powerful new definitive platforms have become available to detect drugs and metabolites that screens will miss and at much lower detection levels necessary. Of course, instrumental screens are still necessary if you want to verify sample integrity using creatinine and specific gravity. GCMS was, for long, our powerful confirmation presumptive positive screening tool used after that initial screen presumptive positive. But GCMS is very labor intensive and not really sensitive for many of the substances of interest. LC-MSMS detects a much wider range of abused drugs and metabolites at the low levels required due to the high potency of many of these medications. In addition, LC-MSMS specifically identifies hundreds of compounds that are not adequately detected using a point of care or even instrumental screening tests. Since patients commonly deny drug and alcohol abuse, this powerful identification will maximize clinical efficacy. For this reason, it's recommended that CMS provide a tiered pricing structure, as you've heard too much about from others, for laboratory methods which properly supports the complexity and true costs of these methods. In a summary sense, urine is not oral fluid, and GCMS is not LC-MSMS. One approach does not work for every drug, and one type of biological matrix does not address every medical question. The proposed requirement to perform integrity checks like creatinine and specific gravity on each urine sample means the use of both instrumental screens and LC-MSMS confirmation or definitive testing will be the federal standard going forward. Reimbursement rates will continue to support clinicians in properly addressing the unique healthcare needs of each of these important clients. I'm happy to answer any questions. I'm happy to leave too.
Okay, at this time, let's take our lunch break and we'll pick it up at 12:30 with our next speaker at that time. So we'll, cafeteria's down the hall, either take the elevator down or the steps down, and I will see you all at 12:30.